Hello and welcome to BusyWorksBeats.com. Today we're going to make a Drake track from scratch in FL Studio 12. So we're going to be using native plugins in this video, and you could always translate that to your favorite third-party plugin. So we're going to go over some sound design, we're going to go over some compositional technique, and we're going to get into some sample manipulation. So Drake is one of the artists who doesn't really use too many kicks and snares. If you listen to a lot of his tracks, some of his tracks don't utilize a kick and a snare, or a drum set for that matter. No hi-hats, no kick, no snare. So it's not typical, and that's what makes Drake stand out. He's not a typical artist. So what we're going to do here is focus more on the music first and then go back and add the percussion movement to the track to show you how to move people along and make them feel the rhythm, just in case they might get lost with the pads and the different sounds we're going to make. Now, that's important to have rhythm in your track because you want the artist to be able to identify the rhythm and be able to sing the lyric to the song. So let's start with sound design. We're going to open up GMS. It comes with the producer edition of FL Studio. So we have GMS here. So I'm not going to use Harm More or Harm Less because you guys who don't have those plugins wouldn't appreciate that. So let's go to GMS. And what we're going to do here is go to Banks, User, Default. So we start back over from scratch using now it sounds like a sawtooth, which is a very common sound design sound wave. All right, so now we have to kind of have a purpose for our sound design. If we don't have a purpose, we're not going to be going in the right direction for the Drake sound. So what I want to create is a dark, moving, purpley sound. Now by purple, I mean a soft sound. So a dark, moving, soft sound. So how can we create that? First, we're going to start with, let me write this down before I forget, because sound design, we might get lost in the purpose. So I want a dark, moving, I'm writing this down, dark, moving, soft sound. So to create the soft feeling, we're going to deal with the ADSR, the attack, decay, sustain, and release. That's how we're going to get the soft, quote unquote, feeling. Also, we're going to deal with the cutoff filter. And to get the moving sound, we're going to use things that move within the plugin, which is the LFO and different envelopes. We can make things move over time. And to get a dark feel, we're going to go with a low pass filter, which identifies those low frequencies, which we associate with darkness. So all those, you know, characteristics are going to be wrapped up in this pad sound. So we're going to start with a sawtooth and just make it wider by adding more voices here under unison mode. We're going to increase this to about 8 voices, and then we can have up to 16, which is a lot of voices. So let's just turn it all the way up, turn it to 16, and increase the stereo width so that all those voices aren't stacked on each other in mono, because that can cause phase issues. So let's just turn the stereo all the way up, meaning they're fully spread left and right. And the detune knob is already set to a certain value. So if I had that at 0, it would sound very sharp and digital. You know, that'd be great for an EDM track or a house track. But we're going to increase the detune to kind of smoothen out the sound a bit. Okay, so you get the idea. So I'm going to play a chord progression just to get an idea of where we're going with the music. And then we're going to go back and do sound design. So let's start with the tempo. We're going to right click, tap our tempo. So 77 is just a number that I have in mind. Now, Drake's style is more slow, but again, remember, the rhythm is what moves the track. The percussion moves the track. So a lot of his stuff is slow. I think he's trying to cater to the Houston area. They're so used to that chopped and screwed music, and it's very slowed down kind of music. So that's, you know, kind of his style. So let's play out a chord progression. Now I'm going to play to the metronome. Okay, and we're going to play some chords, notes, and automation when you record. Okay, so let's figure out a chord progression we can play. I'm going to play something like that. So let's just hit play. So that was an extended chord progression. You want to have a lot of movement in your chord progression. If you want to understand more about music theory, chord progressions, melody, bass lines, etc., you must get the Music Theory Essentials at busyworksbeats.com/music theory. We teach you how to create stuff like this, okay? But I don't want to take up too much time explaining the work through. So what we're going to do here is snap the MIDI to the grid. Just zoom in real quick, slide the notes over, change the snap to grid to something bigger, and then hit Control A, Alt Q. That's going to quantize these chords so that they're closer together. Now what I'm going to do is go back in the actual plugin and start messing with the sound. You know, again, what a lot of people do is they try to get their sound perfect and then do the MIDI. Whatever inspires you. I like to write out the MIDI first and then go back and manipulate the sound, because there can be time changes and different things. So let's go to our characteristics, a dark, moving, soft sound. So let's deal with the ADSR first, because this is what's going to determine the characteristic of the sound. This is going to deal with the transience of the sound and how long the tail of the sound is. So the attack is the initial transient. When I say transient with a T, it's very transient heavy. It's very consonant dominant. Say, okay, so everything with consonant dominance, like C, K, like K, K, D, 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 T, 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 P, 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 and in the comedy movies, all those words where they're spitting on the other person, those are consonant dominant words, and they deal with a very sharp attack, which is a very low attack time. But when I say S, it's a long drawn out kind of thing. So it's like S, and I swell, and that's why we have the word swell for the attack. So we're going to increase the attack so that the sound swells in softness. The more attack we give it, the softer the sound. But you can see it sounds weird with just attack. So now we have to go to the other pieces of the envelope to make the sound a little more natural. What we're going to do here is lower the sustain. Sustain is just when you hold a key, it plays that volume consistently. Okay, so we're going to turn off any consistent volume. We're just going to turn the sustain off. The decay time is how long it takes to go from the attack down to zero volume, okay, if you have no sustain. So that's what decay time means. And then the sound fades away. So it's essentially going up like a mountain and then back down. So the attack is like the first part of the mountain when you go up. The second part would be the decay coming down. So now we need to give the sound a tail so that it lasts longer. So we're going to use the release to increase the tail. So when I hit a key, it lasts longer. So now let's hear the chord progression. It's going to sound a little bit different. Now release adds a pseudo reverb. So it adds what we call reverb, which is echo delay. It adds that kind of atmosphere sound. Now still it sounds like it's going whoo, and then it's really quick. So we're going to increase that attack a little bit longer. So what we can do is override the main amplitude ADSR. So multiple things can have envelopes. This is just one envelope for the volume, the amplitude. We can actually give the envelope an envelope to the filter cutoff. So the filter over here is set to low pass LP. We're going to lower the cutoff frequency. What this is doing is cutting out the high frequencies. And we can get a very dark, blurry tone. And we can actually make this move around. So let's make it move around. Now, when we give it an envelope, the filter cutoff frequency should be at this point here that I'm moving is going to be the minimum. Okay, that's the minimum value. So set it to your minimum value. Now, when you set the envelope to its destination or what it's modulating, we're going to modulate or override the filter. This means we're going to manipulate the filter cutoff using an envelope. So now with the envelope to basically peak at a certain point, the decay time here, or the amount actually, sorry, this is the peak, this is the max amount for the filter. So this is, when I have this all the way up, the filter is completely open, and it's going down in this decay time. Now, if I lower the amount, it's going to have a lower max value, so it's not going to be so bright in the beginning of the sound. Which is what I want. I don't want too much movement. That's very obvious. So we're going to lower the decay time of the envelope there. Now, a cool effect a lot of people like to do is add attack to the envelope, which modulates the filter cutoff. Now, if I increase the amount and if I turn up the resonance, which is essentially an EQ point at the cutoff frequency, you're going to hear a lot more movement. Now, some people like that kind of tone sweeping through. I think it sounds pleasing in this case. I'm just going to pull it back a little bit. Now, some other envelopes give you a little more control, like release and sustain. This one just gives you attack and decay. We're going to increase the decay time of the sound. So what I'm going to do with the MIDI is hit Control A, then I'm going to hit Alt L. We're going to articulate those notes or drag them out so that they fill in the gaps here. And that last chord, I'm going to hit Alt L. Not sure why this one isn't filling out. There we go. Oh, there's a bass note. Okay. There we go. So now we're filling in those gaps with the MIDI so that there's no weird, strange kind of sounds with the sound design. All right, so let's add some more texture to the sound. Let's increase the noise, which is going to be that white noise, wish-wash water sound in the background. We're just going to lower that so it's not as obvious. That's going to fill out the sound a little bit more for us. Now, in FL Studio, you can always right-click to automate in the playlist, so you can always automate any of these knobs. You don't have to use the envelopes directly. So let's see what else we can do for the sound. So we pretty much have the sound made. Now we can start blending in different oscillators, which is going to change the tone of the sound. So let's turn up oscillator 2 and let's start messing with different waveforms. I'm not going to spend too much time experimenting with sound design, but you can go through and do this yourself. So this beast shape adds a very metal tone, metallic tone to the sound. I'm going to lower the octave to negative 12, which means it's an octave lower. There's 12 semitones in each octave. If you want to raise something an octave, you do plus 12 in the semitone range in the pitch. If you want to go down an octave, you do negative 12. So it adds that bass kind of sound. But what I want to do is separate the bass tone from this pad. So I'm going to leave it as a sawtooth, and we're going to create a different GMS, which just has the bass. So we're going to right click, clone this, and I'm going to copy the MIDI and show you how to focus in on the bass. So we're kind of layering sounds at this point. I'm going to hit Control V. So I hit Control C, Control V to paste. We're going to go into the actual MIDI, and I'm going to select only the bottom notes, only those notes in the 3 range where it says A3, G3, F3, E3, D3, and I'm going to select the other notes and delete them, so that this is only focused in on the lowest notes out of all the notes. So let's go into GMS. We're gonna lower the main octave down negative 12. So this is oscillator 1, and we're gonna select beast. So we're gonna get that beast tone again. Now I'm gonna change the parameters here. I'm gonna lower the attack so it comes in right away. I'm gonna increase the sustain so that when I hit a key, it plays its loudest volume and stays there. And we don't need release. But to avoid pops, you want to give it a little release and a little attack just to get rid of any audio pops and clicks. Now I'm also going to get rid of the filter envelope. So to turn that off, we're just going to turn the amount down, which means off. Let's focus in on the cutoff frequency here. Now remember, it's set to a low pass filter. It's going to lower it until we get rid of the very bright tones, because we don't want the sound to kind of override the pad. So we're just getting rid of some bright tones. Then we're going to add resonance to kind of hollow out the bass a little bit to give it that Drake sound. Now what we're going to do here is go into the MIDI, hit Control A, left click and drag the notes so that they overlap each other just a little bit. Then we're going to go to the GMS, go to the wrench tool, and we're going to activate portamento and monophonic mode. And we're going to turn the slide up. This means when I play notes back to back, they're going to slide. And that's essential for that kind of Drake sound. So it doesn't sound like a computer. Dun, dun, dun. It sounds like, and it slides to the next note. Now what I'm going to do here is add a lower octave at negative 24. So multiples of 12, you know, 12 semitones in each octave. So negative 24 means we're down two octaves with this tone here, oscillator 2. So to hear oscillator 2, we have to go to the mix and turn oscillator 2 up. Now in GMS, they have different blending sounds and different plugins have different sounds. So this is blending oscillator 1 with oscillator 2. See, it gives you kind of a very, very low sound. I'm going to change this to a pulse wave to see if we get a square wave. So instead of doing direct oscillator volume, what we can do here is use the modulation 2-to-1, meaning the second oscillator to the first oscillator. Frequency modulation means we can use shape 2 to modulate shape 1. Now this is more complex. For those who don't understand, it's fine. It just means one sound wave is manipulating another sound wave. Now, let's turn up the amount. We're going to go to RM, which stands for ring modulation. It's going to add this kind of circle-y kind of sound to the... We're going to lower the amount. Now, I'm also going to increase the octave so it's not so low. And it adds that kind of helicopter sound to it. It's kind of like adding saturation. Now we're just going to lower the filter cutoff. Let's see if we lower the main sound down an octave. You can see that's a little too low, not pleasing. So let's go back up. Let's hear this in context. Now don't forget, we have these 16 voices and it's stereo spread for a bass. So when you're dealing with bass, it's usually not stereo spread. This one, I kind of left the same settings to get the same character. But just keep that in mind. So let's move this into a different pattern. We're going to hit Control X and paste this into pattern 2, Control V. So now we can go to the playlist and right click our pattern icon, go to pattern 1 for our longer chord progression, and then add the bass line down here. And this is going to be our chord progression. So you're going to get this file. When you click that link below, you can get this file as a free bonus for the new product coming out at busyworksbeats.com, Big Drums. Okay, it's going to be a sound package with synth presets, FL Studio projects, wave tracks. So if you don't have FL Studio, you can actually take advantage of the projects. And then you're going to have drum samples. So it's a lot in there, and we're going to have more details come 9/11, which is tomorrow, and a special offer for you since we're celebrating our history coming together as one. All right, so anyway, let's go back to the playlist. Now, Drake's style, I don't know if I mentioned this earlier in the video, but his style, he doesn't really rely on too many kicks and snares when it comes to this kind of pad-filled sound, because it's just too much going on. So what he does, or his producers do, is add a percussion track. So we're going to use a percussion track as the back rhythm for this song. All right, so let's move into the percussion of the track. Now, Drake's percussion doesn't, it's not very dominant. It's very subtle and in the background. So let's go into our browser. Let's go to busyworksbeats.com. Again, the Big Drums package will be out tomorrow, 9/11/2015. So let's go here. We're going to just choose some drum samples from the kit. Let's go to percussion, though. And we have the Drake kind of snare. Now, Drake has a certain snare. I call it a bouncy snare. It's like boom, ch, 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 boom, ch, 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 ch. It fills in those empty spots between the kick and the snare. So the snare generally goes on the 2 and the 4. So we're going to use that for the 2 and the 4. And we're going to use this one to fill in the gap in between. I'll show you what that means in context. Now, those are the only two samples we're going to use. We're going to mix those in the song using reverb and different techniques to make those really fill in a lot more space. So it just shows you how minimalistic this songwriting technique is. And now, it's, you know, we're coming down to basically 4 tracks and then a vocal. So 5 tracks. And that's a song. So anyway, let's again put this snare on the 2 and the 4. If you don't know what 2 and the 4 are, you want to get Beat Magic from busyworksbeats.com. We go over, you know, how to measure music and go over rhythms and different things in that whole course for you at busyworksbeats.com/beatmagic. So let's add the bouncy snare. So let's add this in context first. Let's add pattern 3 to the actual song. First thing we need to do is tune the sample. Again, I see this all the time. People don't tune their samples. Maybe because they don't know. So tuning the sample, especially for tonal percussion like this percussion here, you have to tune it so that it sounds less dissonant. Dissonance comes from when there's frequencies which do not go together. And that happens when you play really notes really close on the keyboard. Like these two don't sound very pleasing. Okay, well, it sounds kind of good. But anyway, let's just focus on this one. Now let's put these sounds in the mixer first. So let's go to the channel rack. We're going to double click the sounds, go into the mixer. We're going to right click insert one, go to channel routing, route selected channels starting from this track. So now we can account for the sounds and manipulate the effects. So let's deal with the tone of the percussion here. If anything, it should go, should be lowered, or it should be raised. Okay, so I know those were off tone. So let's select the pitch range here for 12 semitones. This is going to give us a bigger pitch range to manipulate the sample. So let's say we wanted to raise the pitch. Let's just move this knob up. That sounds great. Okay, and that's plus 120 cents. So you can work your way around to make the pitch match the chords. So that's a great tone. Let's go into our mixer now and let's add more reverb effect to the sound to fill in a lot of the dead space. So we're going to open up Fruity Reverb on the percussion track and we're going to give it a long decay time. So about 5 to 7 seconds, very long decay time. We're going to increase the stereo width of the reverb and give it a little pre-delay so you can tell the difference between the sound and then the reverb. Then we're going to work with the cutoff here. Now, if I increase the high cut, that's going to allow more high frequencies. And sometimes that can get in the way. So you want to blur that out sometimes. So now you can see that one small percussion now has two functions. One is to keep the rhythm and the other is to fill in the frequency gap using the reverb. So I forget who said it, but somebody said, some producer somewhere, and I can't recall the name, said use reverb like an instrument. It's an extra voice. It's an extra tone within the song. So now let's go to pattern well, let's keep it on pattern three. I want this to be the bounce snare. So I wanted to go boom. Now we're going to edit the sound so it doesn't sound like it is right now. And that's what sample manipulation can do. So we're going to click on the sound, go to envelope. We're going to go here to the filter section, lower the filter or mod X, which is the filter cutoff frequency. So that's going to kind of muffle the sound and get rid of some high frequencies. Then we're going to add some resonance under mod Y. This is going to add more tonality to the filter. Now we're going to manipulate the shape of the sound. So let's go to volume, activate the envelope, go to it, you know, lower your parameters and lower your decay time. Now this sound needs to be tuned as well. So let's give it plus 12 pitch range. It should be ding, ding, ding. Okay, this fits a lot better than the original tone. Now we want to create a small time delay between these two sounds so they don't sound like they're overlaying each other. So let's go here to the wrench tool and let's increase the time shift, which is also called the time offset in FL 11 or below. So increase that time shift, and that's going to delay the sample slightly behind the first snare. Okay, so let's go to the mixer now, and we're going to add reverb to that second snare. But this one, we're not going to give it a long decay. We're going to give it a lot of reverb, but a very, very short decay. And I call this the wall of reverb or the wall of sound. So we're going to go to the pre-delay, give it a noticeable pre-delay, meaning how much time is between the snare and the reverb. And then we're going to let that reverb crank all the way up, but have no tail to it. So it just kind of smacks you and dies out. And that's the result. So you can, you know, mess with some parameters till you get the sound you want. I think it adds a little extra rhythm. Now I'm going to mess with the pre-delay a little bit more to get a longer delay time. And what we can do is actually go to the mixer, right click, create automation clip for the second reverb mix level. So let's say we don't want reverb in the beginning, but at the end we want the reverb to build up and then stop, and then we want it to build up and then stop and then build up again. So this is a cool effect for adding subtle energy to a track, letting the reverb increase over time and then cutting it out. Now we need something else to move. So I'm going to use the pad to keep movement. Let's go back to the GMS pad. We're going to use the LFO to create some type of movement. So if it gets too cluttered, we can always move to a different element. Now the LFO is a low frequency oscillator. It's a very low frequency, which modulates something else. So we can add rhythm to different things through using cycles. Let's go to the shape. We're going to give it a pulse wave shape, which is kind of on, off kind of switch. And we have to tell it the destination to modulate something. So let's modulate the, let's do the filter, I guess. And let's turn this up so we can actually hear what's going on. Now we need to turn the sync mode on to beat mode and then use the rate here to determine how fast it's going to go. So you can slightly hear it go in the back. Let me increase the speed here. Can hear that slight movement, but you got to be really careful with the timing of this, and you got to deal with a lot of things. So instead of the cutoff, let's modulate the frequency using a very slow sine wave. So the amount is going to be very, very low, but I'm going to make it dramatic by turning the amount up here. And let's turn our sync mode to none, which means we're not locked into a frequency or locked into the BPM. So over time, you could hear the pitch going up and down. So it's very subtle, but I'm going to turn the amount down so it's not as obvious. It's going to add that retro sound. It's very retro, and I like it. It's called pitch slop for the Prophet, if you have that synth. Anyway. So let's say you didn't want to write in 440 hertz. Now, what you would need to do is open up Guitar Rig. I know this doesn't come with FL Studio, so I left this out. But I noticed a lot of Drake songs aren't necessarily 440 hertz middle A. So what that means is if we go to Guitar Rig, now open it up, we can have different frequencies for middle A. So if I turn the tune fork on, that's middle A at 440 hertz. The reference pitch here is 440 hertz. Now if I lower the reference pitch to, let's say, 432, it's a completely different tone. 455, 425. Okay, so they sound like different notes. It's the same note, but it depends on which frequency you're focused on. So we have different tutorials at busyworksbeats.com which go over that, how to tune your instruments. But that's very important in songwriting. So if you were to tune your Cylinth, for example, or whatever plugin you're using, this is GMS, you would open up Guitar Rig, play the note you want to play, and let it detect which note you're playing. So this has pitch movements, remember, so it's not going to stay steady. But I'm playing the note B. Okay, so it should be saying B0. If I turn off the pitch amount, let me copy this value before I do anything. Now also, detuning is going to mess with the pitch a little bit too. So this should read somewhere around B. Okay, so if I... Those match in tone. Now if I change the reference to 425B and I play the note, okay, they sound completely different. So that's why you really need to tune your instruments. And Drake doesn't necessarily tune to 440 hertz. So you might want to go in and change your pitch here until it matches whatever note you're playing at whatever reference you're playing. We have a video on that. We'll put it on YouTube for you guys. I just wanted to tell you that that's very important for a lot of artists. All right. So let's change the key of the song. Let's say we don't like these chords, but we like the way they move. So let's change it from A minor. Let's just hit Control A. Let's move everything up. Now I'm going to mute the bass because you have to move that MIDI as well. I'm just going to move this up to see. So you can transpose the key without even doing much as long as you have your chord progression. Now this is going to give you new tones and new insights into chords you may not have been able to imagine in your head. And I like this tone better actually with the A flat or the G sharp. So I'm going to go back into pattern 2. I'm going to do the same thing with the bass, hit Control A and move that note to G sharp so that they match. Okay, so that's important if you're taking care of that. We're gonna make the percussion a little more subtle. Turn up the pad a little bit more so it's not being outshined by the bass. Let's see what else we can grab from the big drum sound package of busyworksbeats.com coming out tomorrow. Let's add a subtle rhythm. Now I'm going to show you how to create very subtle rhythms using hi-hats. They're not going to sound like hi-hats when we're done with them. So I need one short, one long. So we're going to use a short one and one long one. Let's go to pattern 4. So I want the pattern to go t-t-t-long, t-t-t-long. So let's go 1, 2, 3, long. Okay, so that's the pattern. Now it's not going to sound like that when we're done, but let's hit shift, highlight the second hi-hat. Let's go to the mixer, right click, channel routing, route selected channel starting from this track. Let's go to the first hi-hat, which is a very short decay time. Let's go to the envelope, and here's where we can kind of override the transient of the sound to give it a more subtle sound. Let's activate the envelope for the volume. Let's increase the attack, which is going to give it a swell type of sound. Let's go to the second hi-hat. Do the same thing, just increase the attack there. This is going to make it seem like it's in reverse when we have that volume swell. A lot of Drake sounds are in reverse. You could even try the reverse, so you can flip the sample. The thing is, there's a lot of dead space, so you're going to have to right-click, go to edit, and just delete all the dead space that you don't need and bring that sample back, and then you could try it reversed if you like that sound. Let's make sure we lower the volume. Now also what you could do is give it a defined length by lowering all these parameters and increase your hold parameter and give it a piano roll note length. Okay, so this is another way to override so it doesn't ride all the way out and make that clipping noise. And you could also drag the sample out so you could time stretch. Let's go here to mode, E3 generic. Let's change the pitch here to a lower pitch so it sounds weird. And let's give it a low pass filter so we blur out some of those high frequencies. Make it a smoother tone. Now if you want to change the pitch of the sample, you're going to have to use this pitch knob under time stretch if you use E3 generic. Now I'm going to hit the time shift and I'm going to give it a little time shift delay. Because there's a little clip at the end. I'm going to shorten the notes just slightly so we get rid of that beginning click. Okay, so we transform those hi-hats completely. So let's hear it in context. Now again, the hi-hat still sounds like a hi-hat, so I'm going to give it a longer attack. Now I'm also going to go to the mixer here and add a small bit of fruity delay to give it more rhythm and a longer tail without sounding like a hi-hat. We're going to go to ping pong mode, increase the pan width, lower the input volume, change the time here to 2 steps. Let's actually go to 1 step, increase the feedback. So it still sounds like a hi-hat. Let's give it some fruity reverb. Blur it out a little bit by lowering down the dry level, turn up the wet level, increase the stereo width, give it a little bit of decay time, and open up your cutoff. If you don't want that much bright tone, lower your cutoff. Give it a little pre-delay. Give it a little more time shift. So it's a very subtle hi-hat. You can barely tell it's there. So instead of having this kind of swoosh backwards thing, let's clone this pattern, get rid of it for pattern 5, and let's have it at certain sections. So pattern 4 is when that little swoosh thing comes in. So it's not playing all the time. Alright, so let's do a little more mixing. Now, we're not going to mix completely because that just takes time. And we have videos on mixing that you can watch at busyworkspeech.com/mixingacademy. Right now, let's just focus on the bass. I want to make it a little more a little dirtier. So let's click here. Let's open up Fruity Blood Overdrive. We're going to lower the post gain a little bit, turn up the preamp. This is definitely going to add a saturated sound. You got to be careful though with your gain knob here. Now also I want to add some post filter. This is a low pass filter we can add after it's processed to smooth out the sound a bit. So that adds an extra bit of bite. Let's go to the EQ, boost up some low frequencies around 60 hertz or so. Give us a little more subtone in the ear. But you can see when we turn the bass way up, okay, the pad seems like it's a little mouse. So you gotta be careful with your levels here. We can still feel the bass at this volume. It feels more together. I'm going to show you the quick way to get the reverse sound. Now this is not the only way to do it. I'm just going to record the track on the master track, open up Edison, we're going to go to new, we're going to record on input. This is going to record as soon as something comes through this master track, which is the whole track. I'm going to add one track way over here just to let me know, just to leave time between it restarting again, and we're going to record the track and you know, put it into waveform so that we can visually see what's going on. So let's do that. Okay, and that's the gap, so let's stop that. Now we're just going to drag the audio into the playlist so we can see what's going on with the track as a whole. I'm going to call this the master track wave. All right, so we're going to have to chop it up a little bit. Go to none, snap to grid, go to your slice tool. We're going to have to slice out the little silence in the beginning here, as you can see. We're going to right click to get rid of the excess. Just move that forward a little bit. Do the same thing with the tail at the end. You don't need it for this reference. We're going to right click and get rid of it. So now I can mute the other tracks and we can hear the master track by itself. But what I'm going to do here, actually, let's show you in Edison, because it's more important to show you in Edison because Edison has the tools. So before you export the wave into the playlist, you can actually go through and mangle different things using Edison. So let's say you wanted to reverse a certain section. Let's say you wanted to reverse those last two chords. So these chords here. Whoops. So to get to, if your screen moves around like that, click this little arrow so it doesn't bounce around. Okay. We're going to zoom in. The chord's around somewhere. So I think it starts right about here. So what we can do is select that area and then go to tools. Let's go to reverse. So that's going to flip the audio. Now if you don't want to flip two chords, you can always hit Control Z, select one chord, and right about there, the chord switches. Now this is where you're going to have to be a very, you know, surgical about it. So right about here, I'm just being rough. It's a rough estimate. Let's go to tools and reverse that section alone. So let's hear this in context. Okay, it adds that kind of Drake kind of reverse energy thing. adds a lot of tension to your ear because you're not used to that. Now, of course, you want to be more surgical about that because you can even see in the audio where it starts to reverse. So, of course, you want to take time and really manipulate that. But that's a technique you can use to make your song more interesting. You can reverse certain sections, like maybe this section here. Let's just reverse that randomly just to hear what that sounds like in context. Okay, maybe not the best spot. But good spots to reverse are right before the downbeat. So let's count the bar. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 2, 3, 4. Boom, 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 and. So right about here would be a good spot to reverse. So since there's no, you know, kick drum to kind of let us know we're back in the beat, let's just stretch this out a bit. So we start, that's where the beat starts again. So let's hit tools, reverse. Okay, so those are usually good spots to add reverses. Because that's where it's, when you reverse the track, it adds tension. We're not used to that sound. And tension is always great before we come back into resolution of a chord. Okay, so, you know, it's more music theory talk. But those are the techniques of how to get the Drake sound. So thanks for watching today. Again, you get this free project when you click that link below and sign up with your email. You get this project for free. And click that link below for more information about the Big Drums sound package coming tomorrow, 9/11/2015 at busyworksbeats.com/bigdrums. So click that link below and sign up with your email to get this project for free. And we may even send out more free gifts. We never know. Thanks for watching today. It's BusyWorks Beats. Daca.